top 100, there are more than 20 students from Shankaraya's academy. So, like, we have given around 25% of the total results of the overall UPSC recommended candidates. So, this is about the results of Shankaraya's academy in the 2019 CSE results. Okay. So, like, about the academy, we are in this particular arena for like 15 years. We have started academy in the year 2004, and from then on we have produced more than 1,000 civil servants. We are in Chennai, Bangalore, Trivandrum, Delhi, Coimbatore, Trichy, Madurai, and in Trivandrum also. So our coaching will be like from the basics. We will start the coaching from NCRTs, from how to read newspapers, how to take notes from the newspapers. So each and every stage will be like very comprehensive, and the entire process of the course will be around like 1 year. It will cover each and every subjects of the preliminary, mains, and we will also give free guidance to the interview students. And like we will be having a lot of guest lectures from various IPS officers, environmentalists, social service activists, and you will have particular classes on current affairs. And also I think the guest is online. We will start the session, and after the speak the guest, we will have a question and answer session.
Good evening to all of you, and it is my pleasure and privilege to be a part of this seminar today. Being a student of Shankaraya's Academy, I look back to my days as a student of UPSC, preparing for civil services examination. Shankaraya's Academy, I took my general studies and sociology classes through Shankaraya's Academy. And it was very much helpful in clearing my UPSC exams. In first attempt, I should say, it was a wonderful opportunity. And the guidance and the materials they provided was very helpful. In fact, it is nearly 10-12 years back, and a phase where still the coaching institutes was in a very nascent and a very preliminary phase in Tamil Nadu, but still Shankaraya's Academy provided the cutting edge for me in clearing the UPSC exams in my first attempt. Clearing the exam is every aspirant's dream, but again clearing it in their first maiden attempt is like icing on the cake. So I should very much place thanks for the faculty and all members, especially our beloved Shankar sir, for providing me a platform for clearing the civil service examination and guiding me through my preparation. I'm sorry for few glitches. This is my official number, so calls would be dropping. And anyway, I'll try to cut it as maximum as possible. So, starting the talk on the topic that you too can become an IPS officer. First of all, I would like to place a few concerns. I should not say it as concerns. I should say a few things every aspirant should contemplate or should like introspect within himself as to before applying for UPSC, especially choosing IPS as a career. Fortunately or unfortunately, UPSC Civil Services Examination, Indian Police Service, is part of the same exam for the other services like Indian Administrative Services, Revenue Services, Foreign Services and other services. But I would like to say at this juncture that the Indian Police Service is very, very different from the other services. It has a lot of facets. What we generally see in media or the movies or the other forms of entertainment industry is quite contrasting, and it's quite different from the real picture and the real work of a police officer, especially an IPS officer. So the few issues or the three basic things I would like to highlight for any candidate who would like to choose IPS as his first option in the civil service examination would be: number one, that First of all, whether will you be able to take up the police as a career? Because police as a career is very, very different from the other services of government. I would rather say it is not as a career, it is as a service. Because the public and the media and all the other pillars of the government and our democracy expects a huge paradigm change in the way police operates in India. So police as a career and as a service is very tough. So first of all, every person should be able to identify whether the police, pursuing police as a police service as a career, is within him, whether he is able to take it up, or whether his mindset and his orientation is able to be taking a police as a career. Number two, police is speaking, there are a lot of myths like how it is connected to civil services. There is a lot of myth connected to police as a service also. For example, people think police is a very, very physically challenging. Of course, it is a physically challenging profession. But I would say more than physically challenging, it's a mentally challenging profession, because you have to manage a lot of pressure, a lot of deadlines, a lot of tasks, or a lot of targets, which is generally not achievable in the general standards. For example, the standards and the results, what we aim, would not be matching with the resources. So mentally, police is a very tough career. So first of all, the candidate should be able to think whether police as an option, as a career, would be mentally easy, suitable for that profession. And number three, which again comes back to my first point, police as a professional option in civil services. Basically, the paradigm has shifted. If you take the two eras, like during British and after independence, after independence, we are slowly moving towards service-oriented policy. Because when British were ruling the nation, they had the single agenda of making the most out of the economy, and they used police as a form of a repressive force for implementing their agenda. Even the laws, everything is mostly suited for their operation. But after the independence of our nation, we slowly started moving towards policing as a service, policing as a field where we can contribute for the betterment of the lives of the citizen. And policing as such is a very important part of our internal security paradigm of our nation. Because for any developmental activity to take place, the most important thing is the regulation, the implementation, and the maintenance of law and order. Because if you take the case of any state, for example, case the state of Tamil Nadu, which is number one in the implementation on the maintenance of law and order in the country. We recently ranked first according to a study. The growth opportunities and the development opportunities and the environment is very conducive for business and the other activities to thrive. So policing is a very important aspect, and we are the first responders. If you take the case of a terrorist attack or anything, there might be so many organizations, there is NSG, there is so many other organizations, but still, police is the first responder for any crisis, whether it is a natural calamity or a terrorist attack. So the expectations of the public and the standards of service, which is we as a service, we as a department to provide the public, is very, very challenging. It is very, very tough, and the expectations of public daily grows day by day. But so when we come back to the aspect of good governance, the most important thing of good governance is transparency, accountability, and ownership. When there is these three things involved in the actions of any government agency, then the aspect of good governance comes over there. So policing as a service, as a career, again, whether the orientation of certain public service is very, very important. Many times we have to keep our service before self. I should say not many times, most of the times, in fact. So I would like to say that these three things, every candidate or every aspirant should have these three things in mind before choosing police as a career or a profession in civil services. all this said and done, I'm not intimidating, and it's not a very serious thing, because everything is developed over a period of time, and the mindset is what we set, and it's rather it's like how you exercise. Mind is the biggest muscle, I feel, in our body, maybe not in size but in the power. So the more you exercise your muscle and keep it under control, the more healthier you are, and more better you can contribute towards any function, maybe whether it's your preparation or later once you get selected in the civil services, performing in the field, providing the public the much needed good governance, what we expect. Because most of the world's best organization, including the United Nations, they have already moved towards good governance. And any government which operates on the paradigm of good governance will be able to contribute and will be able to satisfy the needs of the citizens in a better way. So coming back to again police as a profession, I would like to touch upon areas. I would not talk about the exam pattern or the other aspects of preparation. Maybe I would like to answer those questions during my question and answer session. Right now, I would like to talk about policing, how it is different from the other profession or other services of the government. IPS was my first choice. Maybe I started my civil services preparation with the note that I should become a police officer, because I was very much interested and I was very much fascinated towards uniform. Uniform always meant two things to me. One is responsibility, and number two is providing the much needed justice to the people for whom they feel their justice is not provided. As we say, justice delayed is justice denied. So I feel these two things have always fascinated me. And I feel as a responsible citizen, policing is one way where we can contribute for the betterment of the society. So in my careers of spanning nearly 10 years, I got selected in 2010. And I was first allotted to Manipur cadre. Then due to some personal compulsions and also some reasons of my own, I wrote the civil services again and I got selected in 2014 and I joined my home cadre, Tamil Nadu. So nearly in this 10 years of my service, there have been a lot of moments which has made me very satisfying, very happening, I should say. There was an instance, I had told it in a previous video also. I was able to save an elderly man who was kidnapped within four hours. It was a real hot chase, like compared to any movie scene. So I was glad that we were able to save him within 4 hours. And that old man, when I met him back again, he was telling that I am a very pious person. I used to pray to God, but right now, the only God I feel alive before me is your police team and your police officers. So likewise, in any police officer's career, there will be a lot of moments which will make you really worthwhile and really meaningful. Police is not like what you see in the movies. It's actually, there's a lot of paperwork involved in police, starting from the police station up to the rank of the topmost police officer in the state, like DGP, what we call Director General of Police. There's a lot of paperwork, a lot of document work involved, and we have to involve ourselves in a lot of policy making issues and a lot of implementation of laws and other things. So it is not as black and white as what is shown in movies. It's not a good cop or a bad cop. There are a lot of areas which is not shown to you. But I would certainly say this, that being a police officer, that sense of working for the betterment of your country and your nation and your society is huge. It's huge, and there are a lot of instances and a lot of situations where you will directly feel that you would be doing a thing which will be promoting the betterment of the lives of the people. So policing as a career is really very, very, very fascinating, I would say. And there are a lot of opportunities. Policing is not only about law and order. Right now, I'm superintendent of police of Nagapattinam district. Right now, this is a law and order post. But there are other things of police. Police basically is a very functional and a professional organization. There are a lot of things in police like intelligence, law and order, training, armed police. There are many traffic planning cell, technical cell, in fact. There are a lot of police is a very, very professional organization. Tamil Nadu police is a premier police organization in the country, which is leading the other state police forces. A lot of people take lessons from us and implement their own mechanism in their states. So policing is a very professional and a very functional aspect. And you can also take up assignments like UN, Interpol, and other foreign based postings also in the, as you grow up in the career. Again, you can also work for organizations like CBI, IB, RNAW, then also central police organizations like CRPF, BSF, etc. So policing is a very diverse career. It's not only related to law and order or what they show in movies. There are a lot of opportunities for you to work. You can even work in civil aviation security, Bureau of Civil Aviation Security. Because there is it's a multiple choices you have. And it gives you a very good choices of career. Then coming back to the work of a police officer, the work of a police officer is not as simple as what is shown in movie. Again, I am coming back to the same point. Here it is involved mostly with respect to implementation of laws, following of procedures. The three main acts which police follows is Indian Penal Code, Criminal Procedure Code, and Indian Evidence Act. Of course, there is other plethora of laws, but these are the main bread and butter of the police force. So police force is basically a very professional force, and it involves a lot of documentation work, and it also it's a very meticulous work, and it's not like a frivolous work what is shown sometime in movies or something. And policing is challenging also, like what I said before, in the sense that policing is very undefined. There is not scheduled tasks. Like some departments, for example, you take case of a health department, or if you take case of an education department, schools have a policy, they have a syllabus, teachers have to teach, exams have to be conducted. But police is very uncertain. The daily routine of a police officer is not the same. You get to have law and order issues, you have to handle agitations, you have to handle public. Sometimes there is to be road rocos, rail rocos. There might be heinous crimes like murder cases, dacoity, rape or something. There might be agitation by the public for electricity or water. So police work is very, very uncertain. So that is the real challenging aspect, because there is no standard operating procedure for these instances. Everything has to be tailored according to the situation. For example, recently I had to handle a crowd of 500, nearly each side 500 fisherman people due to some issue between two fisherman villages. So there is no cutthroat procedure, or there is no simple answer or simple solutions for these kind of problems. It's what innovatively you think and you handle the situation, and how well you are able to address the crowd and satisfy their aspirations. So challenging wise and opportunities wise, policing is very, very good, and it gives you a lot of opportunities to prove your mettle, and it gives you a lot of opportunities. That satisfaction, most of my friends, I would say that most importantly, the satisfaction is the most important thing. Whether you are a police officer or a civil servant, or you are an entrepreneur, or you are whatever you are, whatever field you are, the satisfaction which comes directly from your work or from your mind, like how you perceive the work you do, is very much important. And policing gives you a real that pleasure. So many days when I go back to my home and when I share to my mother or my family that today this thing happened, and you are able to say do this, and you are able to help a lot of people. the look or the happiness I see in my family members' face, or the effect what it brings in them, it's very good. So it's like a mutually satisfying thing. So policing as a career provides you opportunities where you will really feel satisfied, really feel happy to be wearing the uniform. Then again, recently, sometime back, when I joined the police service, I was told by a veteran officer, that policing, how it is going to be important in the coming days. Like I said before, as a service, policing is becoming tough, is becoming heavily loaded. But the other aspect, where the real policing, the hardcore policing is there to tackle crime, to tackle issues, to maintain the law and order in the society, or to keep the internal security aspect of our country safe and the frame intact. It's very, very important that we have a sound and a very strong and a very professional police force. So my friends, I will say it's a very, very challenging. For example, everybody would be seeing, would have seen Rainbow. So the seven colors, Bibjior, what you call Bibjior, you must be knowing. So every color symbolizes a word. So if you take that acronym and put it like V is for violet. So violet, what we take, violet is violent, violent crimes like gangs, organized crime, where they do this murder, dacoity and robbery. So the tendency is to involve in these crimes are day by day increasing. So that becomes a very challenging aspect. Then again, take the case of indigo, the indigo color, which represents blue collar crimes, basically wealth, economy related crimes like the scams. You must have seen in the past, like Satyam scam or the big multi-level companies or the MNC scam, which is a very big threat for our economy, because when the economy faces a crisis, again it becomes a very big problem for the investors and the other shareholders. Then again, similarly, if you go take the case of blue is basically the crime which is respect to blue collar is the lower level crimes or crimes happening in the bottom rung of the society. Then green, G stands for green. Green is like demonstrations, protests against the government projects. Recently, you must be seeing there is a lot of land acquisition issues are coming. A lot of schemes which is the projects of the government directly affecting the environment. That also becomes an issue. Then Y. Y is, stands for yellow, which we call the yellow pornography or the those related crime where child pornography or any kind of sexual activity is involved, like POXO related cases or rape or something. Then orange. Orange is for basically the terrorist related activities and the other what we call the fundamentalistic activities, which threaten basically the public's survival, because any terrorist activity is basically attacking the the sovereignty of the nation, whereby they put the public in a threat. Then again, R comes back to red, where we talk about this Maoist and insurgency related crime. So all these crimes are very much relevant. Rather than delving deeply into the, I'd like to put the point in a macro context that all these crimes are existing, have been existing, but the scale or the measure in which right now it is coming back to threaten the social and the economic fabric of our nation is so huge. Cyber crime, yeah, that's a good question. Cyber crime, we can put it in this. The indigo, where it is related to economic, cyber-related activities. So broad scale, what I will say is that the challenges before the police is so huge, my friends. And we need responsible police officers. We need police officers who is having that passion, who is having that courage and the conviction and the ability to stand up to these challenges. Because my friends, this is our nation. we have to stand up to it, we have to protect it, and we have to safeguard it at any cost. Because the whole the country is threatened by all these kind of criminal activities at various levels. There is a lot of organized crime happening, mafias, cartels. So we need a sound police force. We need a police force which is very responsive, which is very proactive, which is very professional. Coming back to my first point. So the challenges before the police force is very, very huge. So I would like to, at this point, stress all of you, please, who is having that conviction that yes, police is a good option, please make it as a first priority in your civil services exam. We need good police officers, we need good policemen, and especially very good police women, both to counter these challenges and also to provide the service related aspects to our citizens. The citizens, especially the lower ranks of the society who are socially and economically and otherwise backward society, who doesn't have much voice, they need a good responsive police force. So that is what I as a IPS officer, I try to train my men, I try to train my officers. Recently we started a 7 months back, we started a program called Veetru. To put it in English, it's called Be Aware or Be Vigilant. We basically started it in 3 phases. I had done a training course. I went back to my National Police Academy. I did a course on missing and victimized children, which really opened my eyes. And I felt a lot of children are being trafficked and a lot of children are losing their livelihood. And friends, again, I would like to put a point here that the biggest resource of India is our demographic debate. I always feel this. India is powerful. Even Dr. Abdul Kalam relies on our main strength as our youth, the human resource of our country. So children form a very big aspect of our country. So we need to protect our children. We need to give them a safe environment. We need to keep them safeguard from this sexual predators, pedophiles, and other kind of things. So we started that program where we were, as a pilot phase, we were able to do the program in nearly 100 schools, where we installed banners and posters telling about various crime against children and how they can report and what are the laws. We gave them a lot of psychological counseling. It was not only about good touch and bad touch. Of course, in fact, we told that there is no touch because every child has a body as a private area. Nobody is allowed to touch that. So we were able to do the program with the help of all the stakeholders. There are around 15-16 stakeholders, child protection unit, a child welfare committee, education department. So we brought in all the people. We roped in a lot of NGOs. We roped in a lot of psychological counselors. So we made a program, and the first phase was completed, and the second phase got delayed due to this corona issue. And then we were able to now since most of the children are at home, we took up the second phase. We are now going to every village, every panchayat, and we are doing a program there. It's like a 2-3 hour program where we show a lot of videos. We talk about instances where the children have been exploited in their own jurisdiction. So that way, a lot of things can be done, a lot of initiatives, a lot of improvements, a lot of good work can be done, certainly by police officers, if we have that will and bent of mind. So policing, again, is very, very humanizing. It's very humanizing, and it's a very, very humbling experience, I should say. I have been talking to a lot of children, talking to a lot of women folk. When we speak very frankly about all these issues, they get a sense of security. They get a sense of yes, they are our police, they are for us. So we are able to make that connection. Basically, that connection is very much needed. Because when India was ruled by British, 1830s, 1850s, where the police was reorganized, once the British took the full control of our nation, they were reorganizing the police force, and they wanted a very repressive police force, I should say. But same time, in Britain, in London, the Metropolitan Police was reorganized. And it was done by a commissioner of that time. His name was George Peel. Friends, if you take the case of George Peel, he had laid 10 principles of policy. And it will be astonishing and surprising for all of us. The same time when they wanted a repressive and a very violent police force in India, they wanted a public and a citizen-based police force in their own London. He says the most important tenet of police function and success of police work can be obtained by only the main principle of public cooperation and support. So he had always told in that when you get time, please go through George Peel's principles of policing, PEL, George Peel's principles of policing. So he wanted a police who is oriented and who is the main orientation should be community oriented policing, and whose main tenet lies on public cooperation support. And he says the more effective the police is, the less the force they use on the public. So I would say that police is a very responsible job, my friend. It's not like what people think. Me, at least in my 10 years of career, I would say I am very happy that I became a police officer. I would always say my friends that I would become a teacher if I had not been a police officer, or maybe I would have taken up teaching as a profession. But I would say, friends, a police officer is also a teacher. He has to create a lot of awareness, and he has to create a lot of bonding with the community. So I feel overall, as a police, as a career, is very, very good, and it's a very, very unique, and it's a very, very charming experience, I would say. And again, on a personal account, I would say it as even a where I can boast about myself. I come from a very humble background. I lost my dad when I was just 10 years old. And my mom, my mother, though she is a doctor, she was my only source of hope. And all she wanted me was to become a good, responsible person. So now I think I have made my mother proud. Every time when I go to my meet any of my family members or relatives, the way they greet me, it's very something which very, very it's a very different experience what I had never encountered before when I entered this career. So I would certainly say the respect and the command and the level of admiration what you get from your friends, family, relatives, and the society is very, very good. It's very, very satisfying. And the respect what you command from the society is very, very huge, my friends. Reinforces my conviction and my responsibility in the wearing this uniform. So as a personal front, I would say that it will certainly boost your career. It will certainly boost your economic aspects. You get a very good salary in the Indian Police Service, and the other perks and the privileges accompanying this is very, very good. So it is both economically also, it is a very, very good opportunity. The entry level salary of an IPS probationer when he joins training after passing civil service examination right now is around 65,000 plus nearly. So I suppose I don't think even a private job would pay you that much just to attend training and to just become a new entrant into the service. I don't think any career would be providing you that much salary except for the top MNCs of the world. So financially also, it's a very, very good career. IPS is a very, very good option. Personally, I would feel that I like the theory of Maslow. So when you grow as per the needs in the need hierarchy, it goes like physiological safety, social, self-esteem, and self-actualization. Policing as an option, as a career, would certainly provide you an option to progress through the career. It really gives you an opportunity to both self-improvement in your lifestyle, in your social mobility. And also it gives you the unique opportunity of contributing to the society and your nation. And it's a very long career, my friends. It's not like 5 years, 10 years. It's like 30 years plus career. I joined when I was very young, when I was 23. So 23-24. So I have nearly completed 10 years. So again, I have more than 25 years of service left over. So a lot of IPS officers also later stages become governor of the states and end up in big other positions also after retirement. So it gives you an opportunity at a pan India level. It's not just a job what you do. You get it gives you great opportunities to become a governor of a state. There are a lot of governors of the state are retired IPS officers. So it's a wholesome experience. It's a great experience. And rather than all these things, again coming back to the point, the service, what you do to the public, certainly that touch, the daily connection, what you make with public, like I daily meet my petitioners, I daily meet a lot of public. So that public contact is very, 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 very humbling. It's very, very soothing and it's very nice. It's a very great experience to hear to people, to know that yes, such things exist in the society, which hitherto before I never heard in my life. So policing is a very wholesome experience, my friends, and there are a lot of things to say, but maybe I would like to answer questions rather than me telling again and again about policing as an option or a career or a service or whatever. I would like to again say now maybe answer your questions. So if there is any questions, I can answer.
So student name is Girisha.
Yeah.
Her question is, I'm a college student. How can I manage my time both in college studies as well as preparing for UPSC?
What I should answer is that I started my preparation only after my college. I did engineering in aeronautics. So after my engineering, I started my preparation. So during my college, I was not into preparation actively. Only thing what I used to do is I used to read newspapers and I used to check the current affairs. So, but if you are going to actively prepare, I would say that maybe you can study NCRTs. Maybe you can study, first of all, you can see the syllabus for your general studies and optional. I think your optional has to be chosen by you. So maybe optional, I think studying during college would not be much possible because you need a professional guidance. That is what I feel from the my point of view. But general studies, yes, geography, history or economics, the school CBSE, NCERTs and other books read by a lot of people, I am sure that you will be able to read all those things. And please follow current affairs. Please follow what is the current day-to-day happenings. The biggest problem now among students is that you live in an information era. 10, 12 years back, I would say that was the starting of the information era. We were not trusted with information. And mostly information which will distract us. But right now you are in a stage where you get a lot of information which will directly disturb you or distract you. So please don't spend time in all those other things. Focus on your career and prioritize. The most important three things what you should have as a candidate for civil services is that three C's. I always go for acronyms so that it is better to talk. Three C's. Number one, you should have a commitment. See, if you are going to take UPSC as a career and if you want to prepare for UPSC examinations, it is good that you are starting at this stage. But the most important thing is that you should be committed to your goal. It's not that after some time you are you think that, okay, I will give an attempt or I will keep it after. Not the case. It should be that you should be able to prioritize and keep the commitment intact, and it should be that you should be able to keep it as your first priority along with your studies. Number two is that you should be able to concentrate. You should be able to focus on what is needed. See, for example, right now in mains, if you take just the case of mains, the number of marks for mains examination, its huge contribution is gone towards the general studies. You have four papers, including the ethics paper. So nearly 1,000 marks, and also the 250 marks for the essay. That is also a part of your general studies, because you'll be quoting a lot of anecdotes or facts or figures or statistics from what you have learned through your general studies. So nearly we take 2/3 of the marks comes from the general studies. And your general knowledge and what is your opinion and what is your perspective about this thing. So it is better to concentrate on the general studies aspect now. And maybe hardly you can spend a couple of hours. Right now, most of us would be spending time in watching Netflix or Instagram or Facebook or WhatsApp or something. Use those time constructively for this thing. And the third C would be to be consistent. See, consistent is very important, because in the civil services preparation, the thing which separates the winners and the losers, rather I would say the successful candidates and unsuccessful candidates, is consistency. See, most of the people, they don't be consistent. Consistent, what I say is, you should have a plan. You should prioritize and you should have a plan. Like, I'm going to cover this subject in this 1 week. This week, next week, I'm going to cover this subject. And they speak this subject. And every day you should make a plan. Like, if you get the time of 2 hours in the evening, I'll spend this time. Morning, I'll spend this time. Like that, you have to prioritize. You have to be consistent. So these three C's, concentration, commitment, and consistency is very much needed in managing the time and the studies. And of course, it's doable. But again, coming back to the point, don't stress yourself. Don't overthrust yourself. The preparation should be an enjoyable process. Friends, I would say that when I joined the preparation, everybody was, I was very new. In fact, I never had any idea of civil services except for the exam pattern or something. So when I joined coaching, there are a lot of people who will intimidate you. They will say that I used to study 15 hours a day, 16 hours a day. I will not be able to clear in the first attempt or the second attempt or third attempt. But always make sure one thing in your life, that you are your example. Don't compare yourself with anybody else. So you have a plan. You have your ambition. You have your commitment. You have your concentrated plan. You have your consistent way of working out things. So, and number two is that don't get stressed or depressed, or don't overthrust yourself. Have a good hobby. Try to manage. Like what my hobby, I used to work out every day an hour. So where I used to get de-stressed myself. Then after studies every day, I used to read a book. Since IPS was my first option, I used to read autobiographies of IPS officers. I read the book of Mr. Vijay Kumar. I read the book of the biography of Paramount Cop of Mr. KPS Gill. I read the book of Mr. Ribeiro, Bullet for Bullet. So I used to read about police officers, because that used to inspire me. That used to make me more committed towards a goal. So always have a hobby or do a thing which actually rejuvenates you and also pushes you towards your goal. Don't compare yourself, and don't try to focus things which will distract you. Like, if you have friends maybe in IT sector or somewhere, don't try to compare yourself with them, and don't try to put your goals or your plan commensurating with them. That won't match. So you should have your own plan. Next question.
So next is interesting question. So what was actually in your entire the 10 years of service, what was the proudest moment?
Yeah, proudest moment of my career, when I was in Manipur cadre, when I was serving in Manipur cadre, I was as ASP. After your training, you had posted as assistant superintendent of police. So I was involved in operations. I was in for a long time. I was in operations, and Manipur is an insurgency prone state. So there used to be a lot of economic blockades. So we used to run a lot of convoy operations, and we used to run a lot of protecting the convoys which comes through the two highways. So, and we did a lot of operations also, for which in my first year of my service as an assistant superintendent of police, I was awarded this commendation disc. And there was an encounter where we lost one of our police brethren also, and we were able to eliminate few terrorists. So I got this commendation disc from my DGP, Director General of Police. So it was in my first year of my ASP ship. It was in 2012. 2013. So that was my proudest moment of my career. There have been a lot of other moments, but since this was my first, always first is the most important and the most highlighted aspect of your career. So that way, this is my proud moment, I would say.
Okay. The next one is another, that is also very interesting. Who or what inspired you to choose IPS?
Yeah, what inspired me to choose IPS as a career? Like I said before, uniform was my motivating factor. Whenever I see uniform as two things, as I said before, responsibility and also serving the society and protecting the country. So I always wanted to be an Air Force pilot. That's why I chose aeronautical engineering. So when I was not able to make it to the Air Force, then I landed up for civil services preparation, as I wanted to become an IPS officer. But before that, I would say when I was in my higher secondary, during my school, it was in 2002-2003. That time, the Commission of Police of Chennai, I belong to Chennai. So the Commissioner of Police was Mr. Vijay Kumar. Everybody must be knowing Mr. Vijay Kumar. He is a legendary IPS officer. So he was the Commissioner of Police. He did a lot of things for Chennai. He revamped the Chennai city's patrolling scheme. He changed the orientation of police. He made a police more people friendly, responsive. And also subsequently, he was posted as Additional Director General of Police of a Special Task Force, where he was successfully eliminated the Brigand Veerappan. So he's an inspiration for me. And there are a lot of IPS officers. There are a lot of IPS officers. But the first point I would say that he inspired me very much. And subsequently, when I started to follow police officers, there are a lot of police officers. Dr. Sailendra Babu sir is also an inspiration in many ways for me. And there are a lot of IPS officers who we adore. KPS Gill, the man who single-handedly took the Sikh extremism in Punjab, the only police force in the country to wither away any kind of extremism. And of course, Mr. Walter Devaram, I should say, is a very legendary doyen. And in fact, I should say he was the first ASP of Thoothukudi town subdivision, where I was ASP after 50 years. He was ASP there in 1966. I was ASP there in 2016. So again, now Nagapattinam, he is the first SP of Nagapattinam district. And now again, I am the 42nd SP. So Mr. Devaram was very successful in dismantling the Naxalism in Tamil Nadu. So there have been a lot of inspirations in police.
Yes. Next question. To crack the civil service exam, should we join in coaching center or can we prepare by ourselves at home?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's see, friends, I would like to say this. If you take a case of a competitive race, if you take a 100 meter race or a 200 meter, you have the option of wearing your spikes, your shoes, or you can run barefoot. So I would like to compare this example. If you prefer by yourself, it's like a barefoot. If you take up some coaching center, it's like running with the spiked shoes. If you are a runner, if you're an athlete, you'll understand that running with the spike shoes give you an advantage. It gives you a soothing effect. It gives you that cushion effect. It gives you that comfortable. Likewise, if you join a coaching institute, you will be able to focus your priorities. Again, I would say that that information thing, what I was mentioning just before, there are a lot of information. Even if you take the case of UPSC examinations, there are a lot of books. There are a lot of sources. There are a lot of materials. Even if you take case of an option like geography or sociology or public administration, there are n number of books. If you take the case of public administration, when I took public administration, there were like 25-30 books. Which will you study? So that cushioning effect of making you feel confident and making you focus, making you guide properly. Yes, this is a good source. And making you relevant to the present standards of preparation, present that examination pattern and how questions are asked. That way, I would say that that focus and that thing and that that proper approach and the proper perspective is given by a coaching institute. So they will be very, very easy in making you oriented towards civil services. So I feel that cushioning effect and that effect of what a spike does to a runner athlete, the academic gives you, the coaching center gives you.
Yes. The next is also another interesting and informative question. After clearing, after entering into Indian police service, how to get into CBI or as you mentioned, research and analysis wing, RNDW and Interpol?
Yeah. So, IPS officer's career is years based and your promotions are as per the scale. For example, you join as a probationer in the National Police Academy, Hyderabad. You get trained. Then you are sent to your respective cadres. Cadres means the state you are allotted to. Then there you go the district training. Then you become you go back to the academy for phase 2 training. Then you come back and you become assistant superintendent of police, where they put you in charge of a subdivision. Then after 2 years, so 2 years training time including your foundation course at Mussoorie Labasna, it's about 2 years. Then the next 2 years you work as assistant superintendent of police. So on completion of 4 years, you become superintendent of police, where you are being given a district charge. You'll be superintendent of police of a district. Then after 10 years, so 14 years, you become DIG. 18 years, you become Inspector General IG. Then 25 years, you become ADGP. And 30 years, you become Director General of Police rank. So the number of years to get into deputation and other fields like CBI, IB, RAW, the other organizations are number of years of service based. So it is basically 9 years. So after you get your SP, you have to work for 5 years in your CADA, in your state. So on completion of 9 years, you are eligible for deputation to CBI or IB or RAW or any central government organization. But some states, they are given exemption. Like for example, Jammu and Kashmir and northeastern states. After 5 or 6 years of service, you are eligible for getting into CBI and IB and RAW. For organizations like CRPF, BSF, you should be minimum a DIG or a SSP. So you need at least 13 or 14 years of service. Even to get into Interpol or UN peacekeeping or missions like that, you need to become a DIG.
Okay. The next question is, other than UPSC, what are the other ways to enter into police force?
Yeah, police force is a very simple force. Most of the states has only 3 layers of recruitment other than the IPS officers who is recruited by Union Public Service Commission. Generally, every state police have 3 levels of recruitment. Number one is DSP, Group 1 DSP. It is like IPS officers, but it is at the state level. For example, Tamil Nadu Police Service Commission is there, Public Service Commission is there. They conduct exams for a deputy collector and other post in which DSP is also there. So DSPs after 13 or 14 years of service, they get conferred into IPS and they become a conferred IPS. Then next to that is sub-inspector, which is the most important level of police force. Sub-inspectors are the people who wear 2 stars and that red and blue ribbon. They are basically the SHO of the police station. That is, exam is conducted by the state. In some state, it is conducted by the Public Service Commission. But in Tamil Nadu, it is conducted by Tamil Nadu Police Services Recruitment Board, TN Uniform Services Recruitment Board, TNUSRB, which is a part of our Tamil Nadu Police. Then the last level is Constable, the exam is again conducted by TNUSRB, a part of our Tamil Nadu Police. So this is the 3 levels of entry: Constable, Sub-Inspector and Group 1 DSP. Other than that, IPS officers are there. So these are the 4 levels of this thing. Other than that, there is direct recruitment into central police forces. Like Group 1 DSP, they call it Assistant Commandant. Assistant Commandant in CRPF, BSF, SSB, CASF and the other one more, ITBP. All these 5 things you can become.
Okay. Next is another very good question. How to read newspaper for UPSC?
Sorry, come again. How to?
Read newspapers for UPSC examination.
Yeah. Newspaper, people have different opinions and perspectives. I would say newspaper is a tool of information. It's not a tool of learning, because every newspaper will have a perspective, because it is, the news item is written by a author. He is written by a journalist. He will have his own perspective. So you can take newspaper as a source of information. For example, I used to follow Hindu. Hindu used to give a little bit a leftist oriented perspective, which is needed for a civil servant, because if you want to focus on the economically weaker sections, you want to know the problems of the society, it is better to know the problem of the marginalized sections. So in that, what I generally used to do is I used to follow the main page, the front page, editorial columns, if there is some good articles related to government policies or government schemes or some international affairs or some foreign policy. Then I used to read the foreign affairs column, sports column, or the science and technology. Every column, when there is a news which I feel might be asked in the exam or which is very important as a person, as a citizen to know, I used to read that. Some people have the habit of reading line by line. It is up to you. But I would say don't spend more than an hour or 90 minutes in a newspaper. More than 90 minutes is not so effective, because whatever information or whatever the facts you are going to gather from the newspaper, a lot of even Shankar Academy's Current Affairs is a very, very good book. I have seen that. They give a very good journal, very concise, very up to the point, very crisp. Many people do that. There are many websites also. So don't spend a lot of time in newspapers. Just make it a habit so that you will be able to know what is happening in the country, what is happening in the state, what is happening in the nation, what is happening in the world. Otherwise, to get the exam perspective, there, as I said, Shankar IAS Academy or any other academy will give you a very good concise current affairs book which you can go through.
Okay. So next is another question by a student called Vidya. I'm doing BSc Chemistry and going to take Geography as optional. Will I be having any problem in that? That is from Chemistry to Geography.
No, Vidya, no, certainly it will not be. In fact, what I will say is that coming to optionals, I would like to say this, friends. There is two things. I think it is a very long old concept. There is two things called, one is called a scoring optional. Other is called a popular optional. See, people used to say some of the optionals are scoring, but I would say that the scoring is a very, very biased and this thing, because every year there are some optionals is very scoring and some optionals are not scoring. So you need the scoring or the other option. There are some popular options. What is called popular optional means the optional for which there is a right guidance, there is enough number of materials, there is a good way you can get trained in that, which will make you comfortable. And number four, where you can write a lot of tests and evaluate your performance, because optionals is there in mains, it's not there in prelims. So mains being a descriptive written type of examination, you need a lot of practice in writing answers. If you want to score more in mains, you have to write a lot of tests. You have to evaluate yourself. So to evaluate the test and the thing, you need a good guidance and good somebody to evaluate yourself. So all these, taking all these points into consideration, that popular option, there are certain popular options like geography, Tamil literature, public administration, history, psychology, sociology. There are some 7-8 options. There are some other optionals like engineering, civil engineering, mathematics, biology, economics, Sanskrit literature, Pali literature, etc., etc. There are a lot of other optionals. So there is certainly no problem in being a chemistry student or coming to geography. For example, I am an aeronautical engineer. I never had any idea about public administration or sociology before entering the civil services preparation. But in my first attempt, I scored, that time I think 600 was the total marks. I scored 340 in public administration and 320 in sociology. I feel both the scores were very good, because at that point of time in the year 2009-2010, that was a very good score. Anything about 300 out of 600 is a very good score. And me coming from an engineering background and having no clue about these two subjects, I feel it's very good. So I don't think anybody can choose any optional. Make sure these two things, like I said, the popular optional is one thing. The other thing is that the optional should be convenient for you. and you should be confident and you should feel connected to that option. See, why I chose public admission and sociology is that I feel that guidance was better for both these options. And most importantly, I felt connected towards these post subjects. I feel as a public administrator, as a police officer, I need to know what as a public servant has to do. So I wanted to know about public administration. And number two, sociology is a very good subject where you learn about society, basically people. Administration is nothing but culture bound. Administration is culture bound and it is administering the society, for which you should know who are the people you are administering. What is their lifestyle? What is the demography? What is their background? What is their economics? Everything. So I feel both these subjects are very useful in making me a better civil servant. So I chose this option. So I would like to tell you, clearing the exam is one part. Choose an option which you feel connected to. Then your options will be studying and preparation, and also writing it for examination will be very easy.
Last question, sir, please share your interview experience, and were you nervous or confident about your preparation?
Yeah, interview I think is the pinnacle of UPSC preparation, and every aspirant's dream is to attend the interview. And I know even when we start preparing for prelims or mains, we always think of our interview. I attended twice interview. First time I got 220 out of 300. It was Purushottam Agarwal's board. Second time I scored, me being in IPS, and again I opted for IPS. I scored 217 out of 275. This Madam Kilam Sungla was my board chairman. She was kind enough. Both the interview attempts, I was not nervous. I was never nervous. Because I knew one thing. Because this is the best opportunity to show them who am I or why I want to become an IPS officer. If I lose this opportunity because of myself, then I'm going to regret it for my lifetime. So I made sure that I will not be nervous. So to not be nervous, I made sure two things. One is that I told to myself, I will not lie. If I don't know something, I will say no. Madam, sorry, I don't know. Or sir, I don't know. Number two is that I will not answer any question in a premature way. Like hearing the question half, trying to understand what the interview panelist is asking. So if I'm going to answer a question, I'm going to make doubly sure I know what is the question. If I don't know the question, I'll ask them to repeat. So I took time for every question. See, for one example, I would say in my first interview, one of my questions was that they asked me, what do you think of Veerappan? And why Tamil people consider him as a hero? And why he is a very big star in Tamil Nadu? I just thought for a few seconds. Then I answered. My answer was this. My answer was that, pardon me, sir. I am a normal citizen. I am a law-abiding citizen of this country. For me, certainly Veerappan is not a hero. He is a criminal. He is a brigand. And I will never acknowledge any of his activities. The same is case for any common citizen or any law-abiding citizen of the country. But sir, we should understand one fact, that any leader or any gang leader or any brigand or any person has a cult status. And he has a set of followers. Why does he have a set of followers? For those followers or those members, he has done something which has made them very close, or which made them affiliated, or which made them a follower to him. So maybe for those few fellows who got economically or otherwise some kind of benefits from him, they might think him as a leader or a follower or a person of a great stature. Like how it is there for any leader you take, even you take case of any bandit or any bad character. If you take case of this Dawood Ibrahim, he has his gang members. For gang member, he is a hero, but not for the common citizen. So I said, sir, for any citizen of Tamil Nadu, any positive citizen of Tamil Nadu or any law-abiding citizen of Tamil Nadu, he's not at all a hero. So, sir, that general myth of he being a hero is false. So, I think that made the edge, I feel so. And then in my second interview, there was a retired IPS officer. I know him because I had attended his training classes. So, he was surprised to see me coming back for again to the interview, and when I told them clearly that again my IPS is optional, first preference is IPS, and I'm changing the cadre only because I wanted a better place to work, and I wanted different opportunities, and I wanted a change for my personal reasons also. So he jokingly asked me, I know that it was a very tricky question, he asked me, so if you want to change a cadre, and if you said you want to work in a place where it gives you a variety of opportunities, so why can't you marry an officer and change the cadre? I hope everybody knows there is an option of cadre-based marriage. You can get married to a opposite gender and you can change your cadre. So I just thought for a second and I replied him, sir, I believe in myself. That was the only one-line answer I gave. And Madam Kilam Sungla started smiling, and I felt again I stole the show, because when I started the preparation, I believed in myself. Friends, I'll say strongly that please believe in yourself. It's not only about this preparation. At any point in time in life, don't lose hope in yourself. Always believe in yourself. You are the only person you have to satisfy, and you are the only person who is the best judge for yourself. Nobody else is. So please believe in yourself. In any career, any field, or any activity, or any task you take up, please believe in yourself. It is achievable. So that was the most satisfying moment. And one more thing I would like to say at this point is that when I joined 2008, May month, when I joined coaching, I met a person. He had already given 3 attempts, and he was casually talking to me, and he was asking me how many attempts I have given. I told him, no, I just now joined the coaching and I have just taken up the civil services preparation. So he was telling, okay, so I think how many attempts do you think you will take? 3 or 4 or 5. I told him, I will clear it in my first attempt. Then he was jokingly saying, no, boss, it is not possible. You cannot clear in your first attempt. I have seen so many people. It's very tough, boss. You cannot do it. You have to understand the exam first, the pattern first. Then I didn't speak. I came back. Then I realized something. You have a strategy for yourself. You have a plan for yourself. Let's say, if you fail to plan, it means that you are planning to fail. So have a plan for yourself, what you are going to do in the first attempt. So I started writing in each and every my notebook or study book or Selvanagarathnam IPS. Every time I open my book, I used to see that. It motivates me. And every day when I wake up in front of the mirror, I used to think how I used to be when I donned the uniform. It is a small motivating gesture, but I'll say it takes a long run. Because as what Swami Vivekananda says, your thoughts is the most powerful thing. If you have a positive thoughts, it will certainly improve your confidence. It will make you believe. So I was able to clear in my first attempt. I had a plan, and I was consistent. I was committed, and I had a concentration focused on the exam. So I was able to clear in my first attempt, and later when I was able to give the talk in the institute after clearing the civil services, again that same person was still sitting in the candidate side, aspirant side. Maybe I don't know what he was doing wrong, maybe, but one thing is sure, that friends, please don't follow others' example. Don't get demotivated. Don't compare other life, both either positive or negative, with others. You are the master of your own destiny. And you are your solely responsible for your career. So work hard, work with a plan, focused, stay humble, and ensure that you are able to put in your best efforts in the preparation, and never give an attempt without you are confident of making it. So those are my words for you. I think if there is no other questions, we will be able to close the session.
Actually, I think there are... still more than 100 questions.
Okay, so friends, I don't know. I have a meeting at 7 again. I have to review certain things and there are certain things coming up. So I am available on Facebook, Instagram, and mainly on these two platforms. Twitter, I'm not so much active. And my email ID is selvanthecop. I will just type it in the, I think, the answer session. I will just type it.
So many students asked about your
strategy. I'll answer. I'll put that my thing in. I don't know how to type. Is there any way of typing it here?
In chat box, we can type.
Yeah. I'll put it in the chat box. Yeah. So I'm putting it in the chat box. My email ID, I will put it there. It's called selvanthecop@gmail.com. So please drop in any queries or will be available in Facebook and Instagram also. Please drop in. Don't be can be answered later on. Please, civil services career, please give it. And police as a employee, have a thought. The three questions what I did in the of my talk. And thanks for Shankar Academy for giving this opportunity. And I hope we're able to touch more lives and more students, officers, like what they have done to me. I'm very happy for them. For being a part of my civil service preparation, enriching me as a person and also as an officer. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sisil.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pete. Thanks, Chandru. And thanks, Ramesh. I just leave. Thanks, all of you. And I wish you all of you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Prem sir,
yes, sir,
there are many questions we'd like to ask Chandra sir about these questions.
Yeah, sir, sure. I will ask Chandra sir. I will just read the questions. Can you please answer for those?
Yes, dear participants, please stay back. The rest of the questions, Mr. Prem Anand, the branch head of Delhi, will be asking my head of academics, Mr. Chandra Shekhar. So you can get all the answers, all the questions answered by them.
There's a question from a student about optional subject, choosing an optional subject. She is having interest in Tamil literature, but she is afraid about like taking Tamil literature. Can you just tell what are all the qualities I need to like have for choosing Tamil as an optional?
See, regarding Tamil literature optional, only thing is you should write Tamil without any grammatic and spelling mistakes. So this is a very basic qualification. And apart from that, if you have kind of creativity in literature and all, really you can score very well. Easily you can cross 300. So last year, two candidates, they got out of 500 more than 350 in Tamil literature. So definitely you can score very well. Tamil literature is a very promising option. And only thing is you should have kind of interest, that's all.
Yes, sir. Next thing is like taking notes from like standard books like Lakshmikant or Ramesh Singh. So is it necessary to take books from the standard notes from the standard books, or we should go for iterations of reading?
Actually, from standard textbook, my personal suggestion is please don't take any notes. There are a few reasons. Say for example, if you take notes from standard textbook, so what will happen? While reading first time, you will find out some of the important content that alone will be copied in your note. But other contents you will not copy in your note. So what will happen, after first reading, you will not take your textbook much. So you will refer only your handwritten notes. So that notes will not be sufficient, it will not be qualitative notes. So better you read in the textbook itself and you have some kind of markers and highlighters. You highlight whenever you read first time or second time or third time in different colors, so that you will come to know in first reading what you studied and second reading what you studied and third reading what you studied, so that in proper coherently you can understand properly. And taking notes from textbook is actually a waste of time.
Yes, sir. The next question is about like he is a working graduate, he is a working professional, so he wants prepare for the civil service examination, but you don't know how to manage the time and when to start and what to start.
those who are working, better you can plan for 2000 instead of 2021 exam, to you can plan for 2022, and you put your groundwork, I mean the foundation strong, then you can in first attempt you can clear. But you take two years time instead of 1 year, and you can balance both your profession as well as your preparation. Then before your preliminary, you have to be master in your prelims as well as mains. So it will be easy for you after your preliminary examination. Just only for examination time, you have to take leave. So without taking leave, you can prepare and continuously prepare for 2 years. So in 2022, you can take first attempt. In the first attempt, definitely you can get into service. You plan for long term.
Yes, sir. Next question is from a student called Swati. She has already chosen geography as her optional and she's working on it. But she is feeling some difficulties in understanding the topics and the learning examples. Can you just give some tips for me to understand the subject in a better manner?
See, geography is kind of a semi-science subject. So there are some conceptual areas. So for that, definitely you need guidance. So first solution is, if you want, you can join some coaching. Otherwise, you go to YouTube videos. So for all conceptual areas like geomorphology, climatology, oceanography, so all the areas, you can get some YouTube videos. For example, if it is related to tide and cyclones or earthquake or mountain building, or any geography conceptual areas, definitely the YouTube videos will be helpful. But I don't know whether all YouTube videos will be in the line of UPSC. But some of the videos will be like general academic videos, but only with the help of those videos you can get clarity on some concepts. So better you can take some coaching from any academy.
Yes, sir. Next question is from a student called Girisha. I am a college student. How can I manage the time between the studies of college and prepare?
We answered that question.
Yes. Okay, sir. Okay. Yeah. So what are all the subjects? See, Sophia asking about the choosing optionals as engineering subjects as optional, sir.
Engineering, definitely you can take engineering as optional. Only condition is, you should be very confident and you should have proper guidance and material. If you have these two, definitely you can go with engineering option. Not at all an issue. And in the recent past, there are so many candidates are passing, clearing this examination with engineering option.
Yeah, sir. Sir, then like NCERT books, sir, we need to study like all the books of NCERT or like choose the books. So whether it is important to read the science books or you should go for only like humanities.
See, with respect to NCERT, you don't need to read the science and all. Yes, in UPSC, they are not asking any questions related to physics, chemistry, biology. Rather than, they are asking questions related to recent developments in the field of science and technology, like robotics, or nanotechnology, biotechnology, information technology, space technology, defense technology. So, only the recent developments are asked in examination. So, better you refer the Hindu science and technology column every week. That is more than sufficient. And in NCERT, you have to cover only social science part, like history, geography, polity, economics.
Yes, sir. Next question is from a student called Netra. She is asking question with respect to interview. So she is having a lot of nervous. She is very nervous when she is facing any interview questions, and her confidence level is not so high when she is facing questions from an interviewer. So how to get rid of this issue?
See, only by practice you can overcome this problem. What you can do is, first you start answering questions in front of any mirror. So just you observe your body language and your face reaction and all. See, in UPSC, it is not actually interview, it is a personality test. They are not going to check your knowledge and all. Already your knowledge is checked in your preliminary examination, main examination. So your personality test is only for testing your personality. So your personality will be assessed within 45 minutes. To some extent, it will be correct only. So, for known questions, you can answer without any confusion. And for unknown questions, straightly you can say, sorry sir, I am not aware of this, or sorry sir, I don't know. So, that is not an issue. Even if they are asking 40 questions, and for that 30 questions, if you don't answer confidently, you can say, sorry sir, I am not aware of this. But the remaining 10 questions, if it is well-known questions, you have to answer very well. So, they know while asking question whether you will answer for this question or not. So, interview is a very simple process, but only thing is systematically you have to prepare. That's all.
Next question is about the ethics paper of mains examination. So, like, how to prepare for the case studies and like how to prepare for a holistic preparation for ethics. So, because it is like we don't have a proper material for that, and like how to prepare for it.
See, ethics 50% is material, 50% is your character. So, ethics is the only paper which will reflect. I mean, the answers of ethics paper will reflect your character and attitude. So, really, it is a test of a candidate's character, attitude, and the integrity and all. So, in market, there are multiple materials. There are so many materials available. And case studies and all, there is no standard template for answers. Okay, so, case studies, it is depends on situation. And you, based on your intelligence and your knowledge and your decision-making ability, you have to answer. So, for each and every case study, it is unique and it is different. There is no standard template for it. And if you want, we can give you guidance.
The next question is from the student called Yuvraj. Sir, he is telling that he is an average student in my school and in colleges. Can I crack the UPSC examination?
100% you can do. And only mostly average students are performing very well. So, those who are very, very average, like 50%, 60%, 70% marks in their schools and colleges and all, they are doing very well. So, see, with respect to UPSC, they will not bother about your past. You would have received 10 gold medals or appeared, I mean, have 10-15 arrears. Both are same. So, in UPSC, they are going to check whether you are giving proper response to their examination or not. So, that's the only thing they are going to see. And they're not bothering about your school or college. So, average students, definitely they can make it. Provided if you have common sense.
Yeah. Yes, sir. The next question is from a student who is actually have completed the 12th standard now. He's asking about, I'm going to choose the college. So, which team would be better for me to pursue UPSC in the future?
So, if there is a single course which is most favorable for UPSC, those who are preparing for UPSC will definitely take only that course. Mm-hmm. There is no single course which is favorable for UPSC, all are same. There are few courses, like, for example, political science or public administration or economics or history. So, whatever subjects we have, if you read, I mean, if you take that courses, definitely there will be overlapping of syllabus. But that alone will not help you to succeed in civil service exams. There are a lot of other things. So, for example, in general studies mains paper, in preliminary there are 7 subjects, and mains there are again more than 10 subjects. So, single subject will not help you to clear civil service exams. My personal suggestion is better you take some professional degree which should help you in case if you are not succeeded in civil service examination. So, you should be in safer zone.
Yes, sir. Great, sir. Sir, next question is like from a student called Praveen Kumar. He is actually preparing history now, but he is not able to like memorize the years and the names of the kings. It keeps on demotivates him. Is there any suggestions for that to do?
See, in UPSC, for history topic, asking names and years and all, it is over 20, 30 years before. So now questions are very trendy and very unique. See, only thing is, you should understand history. Okay. So they're not asking any names or places or years as such. Okay. So based on the sequence of events, you should know what exactly happened, what are the reasons and what are the consequences. See, actually, it should be like subjective. And UPSC, they're not asking any direct factual questions. See, if they're asking 20 questions from history, maybe one question related to chronological event. Okay, so other than this, mostly conceptual questions, and your answer will be based on your understanding, not about your memory.
Sir, most probably this will be the last question. Again, student Yuvraj has asked the question. So, is learning government schemes is very important for UPSC? Please tell me.
Yes, definitely. You will get at least 4-5 questions every year in preliminary examination, at least 1 or 2 questions in main examination from government schemes. It is very, very important. And we have our website, iasparliament.com. Every day, we are uploading news items from 5 English dailies: Hindu, Times of India, Indian Express, and Economic Times, Business Line. So these are the 5 English dailies we are taking, and we are uploading all news items and editorials. That is more than sufficient for your preliminary as well as main examination. And in the same website, we are uploading some important documents like government schemes, the recent development in the science and technology, international organizations, reports and indices. There are so many things. So you go through that website, you will get a lot of information. That is more than sufficient.
So one more question from Kannan actually. He is very weak in maths. It will affect the UPSC preparation or not?
He is very weak in maths, right?
Mathematics.
See, definitely it is not going to affect, provided if you know some basics of quantitative aptitude. Actually, in CSAT, Civil Service Aptitude Test, there will be 80 questions in preliminary examination. And among these 80 questions, 35 to 40 questions will be from English, like reading comprehension. And remaining questions, again, they say, for example, if remaining questions are 40, after 40, you may have around 20 questions from reasoning and 20 questions from quantitative aptitude. So in that case, to clear the civil service aptitude test, you need at least 50% of quantitative aptitude. Then only you can clear this one. So because you cannot depend only on reading comprehension, you cannot depend only on reasoning. So you have to balance all.
Yes, sir. We have done with the question, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. All the best to students.